This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Greyhawk, also known as the World of Greyhawk, is a fictional world designed as a campaign setting for the Dungeons. 223 The first Greyhawk novel, 224 The first Greyhawk adventures published by TSR 3 The World of Greyhawk Folio Edition 1980 31 Development of Geography 32 Development of History and Politics 33 Publication 4 Between Editions 1980-1983-41 More information about every political region 42 Deities of Greyhawk 43 Non-player characters of Greyhawk 44 TSR Greyhawk adventures published after the Folio Edition 5 World of Greyhawk Boxed Set 1983 6 After publication of the Boxed Set 1984-1985-61 Greyhawk Modules 62 Dragon Articles 63 Gygax Departs 7 Greyhawk Without Gygax 1986-1987 71 Greyhawk novels continue without Gord the Rogue 72 The Dungeons of Greyhawk revealed 8 Greyhawk revived 1988-1990-81 The City of Greyhawk boxed set 82 modules released under the Greyhawk Adventures banner 9 A New Vision of the Flannes 1991-1997-91 The Greyhawk Wars 92 From the Ashes 93 TSR drops Greyhawk 10 Wizards of the Coast 1998-2008-101 25th Anniversary of D. 14 references 15 further reading early development in the late 1960s, Gary Gygax, a military history buff and pulp fantasy fan, started to add elements of fantasy into traditional tabletop medieval miniatures wargames at his games club in Lake Geneva, Wisconsin. He sometimes replaced typical medieval weapons with magical spells, or used dragons and other fantastical monsters in place of soldiers in 1971, as part of a rule set for tabletop battles called Chainmail that he was co-writing. He created supplementary rules for magical spells and monsters as well as one-on-one combat around the same time. In Minneapolis, St. Paul, another tabletop wargamer, Dave Arneson, was also developing a new type of game. Arneson had been impressed by the Napoleonic tabletop Bronstein campaigns of fellow wargamer David Weasley that incorporated elements of what is now called role-playing, such as using a neutral referee or judge and having conversations between the players and imaginary characters to resolve diplomatic issues. However, Arneson soon grew tired of the Napoleonic setting, and one night when the gaming group assembled, he presented a plastic model of a castle in place of the usual battlefield, and told the players that instead of controlling regiments that night, they would each take one individual character into the castle of the Barony of Blackmoor to explore its dangerous dungeons for combat resolution. He started by using rock-paper-scissors, but quickly moved to a combination of rules that combined chainmail and a nautical wargame he had co-written with Gary Gygax and Mike Carr called Don't Give Up the Ship. What set Arneson's game apart from Weasley's tabletop wargaming was that the players could keep the same characters from session to session, and that the characters advanced by developing better abilities or powers over time. Arneson's Minneapolis-St. Paul Napoleonic gaming group was in touch with Gygax's Lake Geneva group, and Arneson mentioned the dungeons of his Blackmoor game that the group was playing on alternate weekends. Gygax was interested, so during a visit to Lake Geneva in 1972, Arneson demonstrated his Blackmoor dungeons to Gygax. Gygax was immediately intrigued by the concept of individual characters exploring a dungeon setting, and believed that this was a game that could be marketed and sold. He and Arneson agreed to co-develop a set of rules based on chainmail in order to provide a playtesting environment in which to develop these rules. Gygax designed his own castle, Castle Greyhawk, and prepared the first level of a dungeon that lay beneath it. Two of his children, Ernie and Elise, were the first players, and during their first session, they fought and destroyed the first monsters of the Greyhawk dungeon. Gygax recalled them as being either giant centipedes or a nest of scorpions during the same session. Ernie and Elise also found the first treasure, a chest of 3,000 copper coins, which was too heavy to carry, much to the children's chagrin. After his children had gone to bed, Gygax immediately began working on a second level for the dungeon at the next play session. Ernie and Elise were joined by Gygax's friends, Don Kay, Rob Kuntz, and Terry Kuntz about a month after his first session. Gygax created the nearby city of Greyhawk, where the players' characters could sell their treasure and find a place to rest. Home campaign 1972-1979 as Gygax and Arneson worked to develop and publish the rules for dungeons. Gygax also continued to develop the dungeons underneath the castle. By the time he was finished, the complex labyrinth encompassed 13 levels filled with devious traps, secret passageways, hungry monsters, and glittering treasure. Although details of these original Greyhawk dungeons have never been published in detail, Gygax gave some glimpses of them in an article he wrote for the European fanzine Europa in 1975, before the rules for D. The bottom level, number 13, contained an inescapable slide which took the players clear through to China, from whence they had to return via outdoor adventure. It was quite possible to journey downward by an insidious series of slanting passages which began on the second level, but the likelihood of following such a route unknowingly didn't become too great until the seventh or eighth level. Side levels included a barracks with orcs, hobgoblins, and gnolls continually warring with each other, a museum, a huge arena, an underground lake, a giant's home, and a garden of fungi. Anyone who made it to the bottom level alive met Zagaj, the insane architect of the dungeons. Zagaj is a reverse homophone of Gygax, and it was Gygax's inside joke that the person who had designed the dungeon, himself, must be insane. Only three players ever made it to the bottom level and met Zagaj, all of them during solo adventures: Rob Kuntz playing Robler, Gygax's son Ernie playing Tensor, and Rob's brother Terry playing Tarek. Their reward was to be instantly transported to the far side of the world, where they each faced a long solo trek back to the city of Greyhawk. Tarek and Tensor managed to catch up to Robler along the way, and the three journeyed back to Greyhawk together. By this time, over 20 players crowded Gygax's basement almost every night, and the effort needed to plan their adventures took up much of Gygax's spare time. He had been very impressed with Rob Kuntz's imaginative play as a player, and appointed Rob to be co-dungeon master of Greyhawk. This freed up Gygax to work on other projects, and also gave him an opportunity to participate as a player, creating characters like Irag and Mordenkainen in order to make room for Rob Kuntz's dungeons. Gygax scrapped his bottom level and integrated Rob's work into the Greyhawk dungeons. Gygax and Kuntz continued to develop new levels for their players, and by the time the Greyhawk home campaign drew to a close in 1985, the castle dungeons encompassed more than 50 levels. Significant player characters of the home campaign, while many players participating in the Gygax and Kuntz home campaign were occasional players, sometimes not even naming their characters, others played far more frequently, and several of their characters became well known to the general gaming world before publication of the Greyhawk campaign setting. Some of these characters became known when Gygax mentioned them in his various columns, interviews, and publications. In other cases, when Gygax created a new magical spell for the game, he would sometimes use the name of a wizard character from his home campaign to add similitude to the spell name, such as Melf's Acid Arrow, Melf being a character created by his son Luke. Some of the characters who became synonymous with Greyhawk at that time included Merlin. Gary Gygax's friend Don Kay created Merlin for the second ever session of Gygax's Greyhawk campaign in 1972. Gygax later recalled that Merlin was the first attempt by a player to make a creative name for a character. In the early days, most players, including Gygax himself, simply used their own name as a basis for their character's name, e.g. Gary was Irag, etc. According to Robert Kuntz, Merlin did not get his trademark six shooters in actual play, but they were given to the character in tribute to Don Kay's love of the Western genre. Although Gygax did not allow the use of gunpowder in his Greyhawk setting, he made a loophole for Don Kay by ruling that Merlin actually carried two magical wands that made loud noises and delivered small but deadly missiles. His name is used for the unearthed arcana item, Merlin's Spoon. Robler. Robler was a fighter belonging to Rob Kuntz. Like Merlin, Robler was also created for the second ever session beneath Castle Greyhawk in 1972, rolled up on Gygax's kitchen table. Gygax suggested to Kuntz the name of Robler, after a minor character in Gygax's novella The Gnome Cache. Because Kuntz was a constant player, Robler rapidly gained power and possessions as the city of Greyhawk was developed. He also became the secret owner of the Green Dragon Inn in the city of Greyhawk, where he kept tabs on happenings in the city. Kuntz quickly grew impatient with play when it involved more than a couple of players, and often played solo adventures one-on-one with Gygax. Robler was not only the first to reach the 13th and bottom level of Gygax's Greyhawk dungeons, but on the way, he was also responsible for freeing 9 demigods whom Gygax revived a decade later as some of the first deities of Greyhawk, IUZ, Raelicious, Tritheron, Arithnal, Olidamara, Heronius, Celestian, Hexter, and Obid High Robler was also the first to enter Gygax's Temple of Elemental Evil, and conquered it completely. Robler also freed the demoness Zuktmoy from her prison at the center of the temple. Kuntz later related that Gygax was very dismayed that his masterpiece dungeon had been destroyed by a single adventurer, and as punishment, Gygax had an army pursue Robler back to his castle, which he had to abandon. Robler also lost possession of the green dragon in Tensor. Tensor was a wizard played by Gygax's son Ernie in the earliest days of Greyhawk. Ernie often gamed with Rob Kuntz Robler and Terry Kuntz Tarek at one point. Using their combined forces of loyal henchmen, the three controlled access to the first level of the Greyhawk dungeons while they ransacked the lower levels. Tensor became the second character to reach the 13th and bottom, at the time level of the Greyhawk dungeons. When he noticed that Robler was missing and went in search of him, Gary Gygax included the name Tensor in the names of two spells, Tensor's floating disc and Tensor's transformation. Tarek, Tarek or Tarek was a character created by Terry Kuntz. Tarek often adventured with Tensor and Robler in the days when the three controlled the first level of the dungeons of Greyhawk. Tarek became the third and last character to reach the bottom level of Gygax's original Greyhawk dungeon when he noticed Robler and Tensor were missing and went in search of them. Irak's cousin, Gary Gygax's son Ernie, originally had a character he called Irak. Later, he created a wizard who, due to a personal issue as part of his backstory, refused to reveal his name, simply referring to himself as Irak's cousin. Gary Gygax knew that Ernie liked the Barsoom stories of Edgar Rice Burroughs, and at one point, transported Irak's cousin to a Barsoom like Mars, where the inhabitants refused to let the wizard use magic. Irak's cousin was forced to become a fighter instead, and learned to fight proficiently with two weapons simultaneously. Simultaneously, eventually he was able to teleport back to Orth, but when he acquired two Vorpal Blades, Rob Kuntz and Gary Gygax decided he had become too powerful, and lured him into a demon's clutches. The demon took him to an alternative plane that drained the magic from the Vorpal Blades, destroying them. Irag, after Gygax made Kuntz a co-DM, this fighter was Gygax's first character, and Gygax often referred to Irag's various adventures in columns and interviews. Irag as simply Gary spelled backwards Mordenkainen. This was perhaps Gygax's most famous character, and also his favorite. Mordenkainen was created in early 1973, and his name was drawn from Finnish mythology due to constant play, often with Rob Kuntz as DM. Gygax advanced Mordenkainen into a powerful character. Gygax never revealed exactly how powerful Mordenkainen was, simply stating that the wizard had 20-something levels. Even years after he last played Mordenkainen, he would not disclose any of Mordenkainen's powers or possessions. Various spells from first edition bear his name, such as Mordenkainen's Faithful Hound, Mordenkainen's Lucubration, and Mordenkainen's Sword Bigby. Bigby started life as an evil low-level wizard non-player character in Rob Kuntz's Dungeons of Greyhawk. Gary Gygax, playing Mordenkainen, managed to subdue him, and forced Bigby to become his servant after a long time and several adventures. Mordenkainen managed to convince Bigby to leave his evil ways behind, and Kuntz ruled that Bigby had changed from an enemy to a loyal henchman, and therefore Gygax could take over Bigby as a player character thereafter. Gygax developed Bigby into a powerful wizard second only to Mordenkainen, and used his name to describe a series of hand spells, e.g. Bigby's Crushing Hand and Bigby's Grasping Hand. For a time after this, Rob Kuntz ruled that all the names of Mordenkainen's future henchmen had to rhyme with Bigby. This resulted in Zigby the Dwarf, Rigby the Cleric, Sigby Grigbyson the Fighter, Bigby's Apprentice, Nigby, and Digby, Mordenkainen's new apprentice who replaced Bigby. Melf. Melf was an elven character created by Gary Gygax's son Luke. Gary Gygax borrowed Melf's name for the spell Melf's Acid Arrow. Rary. Rary was a wizard created by Brian Bloom and played only until he reached the third level, at which point Bloom retired him, having reached his objective, which was to be able to call his character Medium. Rary. Gygax borrowed the name for the spells Rary's Mnemonic Enhancer and Rary's Telepathic Bond. Otto. Otto, like Bigby, started life as an evil non-player character wizard in the Dungeons of Greyhawk. Tensor and Robler defeated him in combat, and when given a choice of which master to serve, Otto chose to serve Robler, thereby becoming a character controlled by Robler's creator, Rob Kuntz. Thereafter, Otto accompanied Robiller on many adventures, including Robiller's destruction of the Temple of Elemental Evil. Gary Gygax borrowed Otto's name for the spell Otto's Irresistible Dance Dromage. Dromage was a wizard created by Jim Ward. Dromage is simply his name spelled backwards. Gygax borrowed Dromage's name for the magical spell Dromage's instant summons, the Circle of Eight. At the point where Gygax's own characters in the Greyhawk home campaign had collectively accumulated both enough wealth that they couldn't easily spend it, and a standing army that rivaled most nations' forces, he gathered all eight of the characters: Mordenkainen Wizard, Irag Fighter, Bigby Wizard, Rigby Cleric, Zigby Dwarf, Felnareth Fighter, Viram Elf. Would not have to travel far to find adventure after 3 years of game time. The result was the Obsidian Citadel, an octagonal castle which housed the Circle of Eight and their armies. Greyhawk firsts the first mention of Orth in the first issue of The Dragon, published in June 1976. Gygax prefaced Chapter 1 of his serialized novella The Gnome Cache with a note that the story's setting, Orth, was very similar to Earth in terms of geography. The first deities of Greyhawk. One facet of culture that Gygax did not address during the first few years of his home campaign was organized religion, since his campaign was largely built around the needs of lower-level characters. He did not think specific deities were necessary, since direct interaction between a god and a low-level character was very unlikely. Some of his players took matters into their own hands, calling upon Norse or Greek gods such as Odin or Zeus, or even Conan's Crom in times of dire need. However, some of the players wanted Gygax to create and customize a specific deity so that cleric characters could receive their powers from someone less ambiguous than the gods. Gygax jokingly created two gods, Saint Cuthbert, who brought non-believers around to his point of view with wax of his cudgel, and Foltis, whose fanatical followers refused to believe that any other gods existed because both of these deities represented aspects of good. Gygax eventually created a few evil deities to provide some villainy in Chapter 2 of The Gnome Cache, which appeared in the second issue of The Dragon. A shrine to Saint Cuthbert, spelled Saint Cuthbert, was mentioned, which was the first published reference to a Greyhawk deity. The first Greyhawk novel in 1976, Gygax invited the science fiction fantasy writer Andre Norton to play Dungeons. G1 Steading of the Hill Giant Chief 1978, G2 Glacial Rift of the Frost Giant Jarl 1978, G3 Hall of the Fire Giant King 1978, D1 Descent into the Depths of the Earth 1978, D2 Shrine of the Kuo Toa 1978, D3 Vault of the Drow 1978, T1 The Village of Hamlet 1978. In addition, Lawrence Schick set his 1979 TSR adventure S2 White Plume Mountain in Greyhawk. The World of Greyhawk Folio Edition 1980 Supplement I, Greyhawk, written by Gary Gygax and Rob Kuntz, was an expansion of the dungeon. The Great Stone Face, Enigma of Greyhawk, and mention of a fountain on the second level of the dungeons that continuously issued an endless number of snakes. The 2004 publication 30 Years of Adventure, A Celebration of Dungeons. Development of geography. See also, political states of Greyhawk. In response to this, Gygax changed his mind and decided he would publish his private campaign world, but with some important changes. Rather than using his own map, which was simply the real world Earth overwritten with his cities, towns and regions, he decided to create a new world called Orth. Gygax joked, "Say it as Oith as if you were from Brooklyn, and that's the way I pronounce it. That annoys all who take a fantasy world far too seriously." Once he had sketched out the entire planet, Gygax decided to concentrate his first efforts on one small corner of the world. One hemisphere of Orth was dominated by a massive continent called Auric. Gygax asked TSR's printing house about the maximum size of paper they could handle. The answer was 34 inches by 22 inches 86. Geographic settings. His map included Arctic wastes, desert, temperate forests, tropical jungles, mountainous cordillera, seas and oceans, rivers, archipelagos and volcanoes. He placed the city and castle of Greyhawk roughly in the center of the map, in an area that would have about the same temperate climate as his home in Lake Geneva. For the other regions that had surrounded the city of Greyhawk on his old map, some were left relatively close to the city of Greyhawk. For instance, the rivalry between the cities of Divers, Hardby, and Greyhawk was a feature of Gygax's campaign, so the three cities were placed in close proximity to each other. However, most other regions were moved further away, scattered across the new map. Gygax also added many more new regions, countries and cities, bringing the number of political states to 60, needing original names for all of the geographical and political places on his map. Gygax sometimes resorted to wordplay based on the names of friends and acquaintances. For instance, Purrenland was named after Jeff Purren, who co-wrote the rules for chainmail with Gygax. Ernst was a homophone of Ernst, his son Ernie, and Sundy was a near homophone of Cindy, another of Gygax's children from Gygax's prototype map. Darlene Peckel, a freelance artist in Lake Geneva, developed a full-color map on a hex grid. Gygax was so pleased with the end result that he quickly switched his home Greyhawk campaign over to the new world he had created. Development of history and politics. Gygax set out to create a fractious place where chaos and evil were in the ascendant and courageous champions would be needed in order to explain how his world had arrived at this state. He wrote an outline of 1,000 years of history as a military history buff. He was very familiar with the concept of waves of cultural invasions, such the Picts of Great Britain being invaded by the Celts, who were in turn invaded by the Romans. In creating a similar pattern of history for his world, Gygax decided that 1,000 years before his campaign began, the northeast corner of the continent had been occupied by a peaceful but primitive people called the Flanae, whose name was the root for the name of that part of Auric, the Flanes at that time. Far to the west of the Flanes, two peoples were at war, the Bakluni and the Sulwa. The war reached its climax when both sides used powerful magic to obliterate each other. In an event called the Twin Cataclysms, refugees of these disasters were forced out of their lands, and the Sulwa invaded the Flanes, forcing the Flanae to flee to the outer edges of the continent. Several centuries later, a new invader appeared, the Iridians, and they in turn forced the Sulwa southward. One tribe of the Iridians, the Erdi, began to set up an empire. Several centuries later, the Erdi's great kingdom ruled most of the Flanes. The Erdi overkings marked the beginning of what they believed would be perpetual peace with year one of a new calendar, the common year Psi reckoning. However, several centuries later, the empire became decadent, with their rulers losing their sanity, turning to evil, and enslaving their people. When the overking Ivid V came to the throne, the oppressed peoples rebelled. It was at this point, in the year 576 Psi, that Gygax set the world of Greyhawk. As Gygax wrote in his World of Greyhawk folio, the current state of affairs in the Flanes is confused. Indeed, humankind is fragmented into isolationist realms, indifferent nations, evil lands, and states striving for good. Gygax did not issue monthly or yearly updates to the state of affairs as presented in the folio, since he saw 576 CY as a common starting point for every home campaign, because each would be moving forward at its own pace. There would be no practical way to issue updates that would be relevant to every dungeon master. Gygax was also aware that different players would be using his world for different reasons. When he was the dungeon master of his home campaign, he found that his players were more interested in dungeon delving than politics, but when he switched roles and became a player, often going one-on-one with Rob Kuntz as Dungeon Master, Gygax immersed his own characters in politics and large-scale battles, knowing that there would be some players looking for a town in which to base their campaign, and others interested in politics or warfare. Gygax tried to include as much detail as possible about each region, including a short description of the region and its people, the title of its ruler, the racial makeup of its people, its resources and major cities, and its allies and enemies. For the same reason that he had created a variety of geographical, political and racial settings, he also strove to create a world with some good, some evil, and some undecided areas. He felt that some players would be happiest playing in a mainly good country and fighting the evil that arose to threaten it. Others might want to be a part of an evil country, and still others might take a neutral stance and simply try to collect gold and treasure from both sides. Publication. See also, World of Greyhawk Fantasy Game Setting. TSR originally intended to publish the World of Greyhawk TSR 9025 early in 1979, but it was not released until August 1980. The World of Greyhawk consisted of a 32-page folio. The first edition is often called the World of Greyhawk folio to distinguish it from later editions, and a 34 inches by 44 inches. 86. Before the folio edition was released, Gygax planned to publish supplementary information, using his column from the Sorcerer's Scroll that appeared on a semi-regular basis in TSR's Dragon magazine in the May 1980 issue. Gygax gave a quick overview of the development of his new The World of Greyhawk folio for players who planned to use large-scale army tactics. He gave details of the private armies that were commanded by some prominent Greyhawk characters from his original home game: Bigby, Mordenkainen, Robler, Tensor and Irak's cousin. Gygax also mentioned some of the planned Greyhawk publications he was overseeing: a large-scale map of the city of Greyhawk, some adventure modules set in Greyhawk, a supplementary map of lands outside the Flanes, all 50 levels of Castle Greyhawk's dungeon, and miniatures army combat rules. None of these projects, other than a few of the adventure modules, were published by TSR, although Gygax originally intended to immediately publish more details of Greyhawk in Dragon on a regular basis. Other projects intervened, and it was not until the August 1981 issue of Dragon that Len LaCofka, in his column, Liaman's Tiny Hut, outlined methods for determining a character's place of birth and languages spoken. Gygax added an addendum concerning the physical appearances of the main Greyhawk races in the November 1981 issue. Gygax gave further details of racial characteristics and modes of dress in the December 1982 issue. David Axler contributed a system for determining weather in the World of Greyhawk. Gygax later said he thought a system of 14 charts for determining the weather was too cumbersome, and he personally didn't use it in his home campaign. More information about every political region. The folio edition had 32 pages, and information about each region was condensed into a short paragraph or two. Gygax realized that some players needed more in-depth information about the motivations and aspirations of each region, and the history of interactions with surrounding regions. With this in mind, Gygax decided to publish a much longer description of each region in Dragon. The first two articles, covering 17 regions, appeared in the December 1981 and January 1982 issues. Due to his involvement in many other TSR projects, Gygax handed responsibility for completion of this project to Rob Kuntz, who covered the remaining 43 regions in the March 1982, July 1982 and September 1982 issues. Deities of Greyhawk. Main article, Greyhawk Deities in the August 1982 issue of Dragon. Gygax gave advice on how to adapt deities from the previously published deities and demigods for worship by non-human races in the Greyhawk world. A few months later, he published a five-part series of articles in the November 1982 through March 1983 issues of Dragon that outlined a pantheon of deities custom made for humans. In the World of Greyhawk, in addition to his original Greyhawk deities, St. Cuthbert and Foltis, Gygax added 17 more deities, although later versions of the campaign setting would assign most of these deities to worship by specific races of humans. At this time they were generally worshipped by all humans of the Flanaas. Shortly after the release of the folio edition, TSR released the adventure module C1, The Hidden Shrine of Tamochin, designed to familiarize players with the Olmen race of the Amadeo jungle, largely based on Aztec and Incan cultures. This adventure introduced the first published deities of the Greyhawk campaign: Mictlantecuhtli, god of death, darkness, murder and the underworld; Tezcatlipoca, god of sun, moon, night, scheming, betrayals and lightning; and Quetzalcoatl, god of air, birds and snakes. However, this area of the Flanaas was not explored further in any subsequent TSR adventures or source material, and these three gods would remain isolated from the main pantheon for almost 20 years. Non-player characters of Greyhawk also included in the March 1983 issue of Dragon was an article detailing four unique Greyhawk characters. The first two quasi-deities, Heward and Keotom, had been created by Gygax as non-player characters NPCs. The third, Merland, was a character that had been created by Gygax's childhood friend Don Kay before Kay's untimely death in 1975. The fourth, a hero deity named Kalanin, was developed to illustrate the principle of advancement of power. TSR Greyhawk Adventures, published after the folio edition of the 10 adventures set in Greyhawk published by TSR before the folio edition. All but one had been written by Gygax. However, the new availability of information about Gygax's campaign world and TSR's desire to make it central to Dungeons L1, The Secret of Bone Hill, Leonard LaCofka, 1981. U1, Sinister Secret of Saltmarsh, Dave Brown. In 1983, TSR published an expanded boxed set of the campaign world, World of Greyhawk, which is usually called the Greyhawk Boxed Set to differentiate it from other editions. According to game designer Jim Bambra, the second edition was much larger than the first and addressed itself to making the World of Greyhawk setting a more detailed and vibrant place. This edition quadrupled the number of pages from the original edition to 128, adding significantly greater detail. One major addition was a pantheon of deities. In addition to the 19 deities outlined by Gygax in his Dragon article, another 31 new deities were added, though only three received full write-ups of their abilities and worshippers. This brought the number of Greyhawk deities to an even 50 for the next 8 years. Greyhawk would be primarily defined by the information in this publication. After publication of the boxed set, 1984-1985 publication of the World of Greyhawk was the first step in Gygax's vision for Orth. Over the next few years, he planned to unveil other areas of the continent of Auric, giving each new area the same in-depth treatment of history, geography, and politics as had been accorded the Flanaas. Gygax had also mapped out the other hemisphere of Orth in his personal notes. Part of this would be Gygax's work, but Len LaCofka and Francois Freudeville had also created material that Gygax wanted to place on Orth. Frank Mentzer, creative creative consultant at TSR at the time, wrote four RPGA tournament adventures taken from his home campaign setting of Aquaria, published by TSR as the first four of the R-series modules: R1 to the Aid of Falx, R2 the Investigation of Hydel, R3 the Egg of the Phoenix, and R4 Doc's Island. Mentzer envisioned them as the first part of a new Aqua Iridian campaign set somewhere on Orth outside of the Flanes. However, by this time, Gygax was in Hollywood on a semi-permanent basis, approving scripts for the Saturday Morning Dungeons slum quarters of the city of Greyhawk to become a world traveler and thief extraordinaire. The novel was designed to promote sales of the boxed set by providing colorful details about the social customs and peoples of various cities and countries around the Flanes. Citation needed. Before Saga of Old City was released in November 1985, Gygax wrote a sequel, Artifact of Evil. He also wrote a short story, At Moonset Black Cat Comes, that appeared in the special 100th issue of Dragon in August 1985. This introduced Gord the Rogue to gamers just before Saga of Old City was scheduled to be released. Greyhawk modules in the 2 years after the Greyhawk boxed set appeared. TSR published 8 adventures set in Greyhawk. 5 were written or co-written by Gygax, and the other 3 were from TSR's United Kingdom division. EX1 Dungeonland, Gary Gygax, 1983. EX2 Land Beyond the Magic Mirror, Gary Gygax, 1983. Both of the X adventures, although nominally set in Greyhawk, transported characters through a planar gate into an alternate reality. UK1 Beyond the Crystal Cave, Dave Brown, Tom Kirby. UK3 The Gauntlet, Graham Morris, 1984. WG5 Mordenkainen's Fantastic Adventure, Robert Kuntz. Managed to get TSR back on firm financial footing. However, different visions of TSR's future caused a power struggle within the company, and Gygax was forced out of TSR on December 31, 1985. By the terms of his settlement with TSR, Gygax kept the rights to Gord the Rogue as well as all dungeons. Greyhawk novels continue without Gord the Rogue. Gygax's novel Saga of Old City, released in November 1985, and Artifact of Evil, released 2 months after Gygax's departure from TSR, proved to be popular titles, and in 1987, TSR hired Rose Estes to continue the series, albeit without Gord the Rogue, to whom Gygax had retained all rights from 1987 to 1989. Estes produced 5 more novels under the Greyhawk Adventures banner: Master Wolf, The Price of Power, The Demon Hand, The Name of the Game, and The Eyes Have It. A 6th book, Dragon in Amber, appeared in 1990 book catalogs, but was never written, and the series was discontinued. The Dungeons of Greyhawk revealed in its 1986 Summer Mail Order Hobby Shop catalog. TSR had listed a new Greyhawk adventure called WG7 Shadowlords, a high-level adventure to be written by Gary Gygax and Skip Williams. However, this adventure was cancelled after Gygax left TSR, and the catalog number WG7 was reassigned to a new adventure, Castle Greyhawk. Released in 1988, it was the first new Greyhawk adventure in 3 years, but it had nothing to do with Gygax's original Castle Greyhawk. Instead, it was a compilation of 12 humorous dungeons levels, each one written by a freelance author. The puns and jokes often referenced modern culture, the Amazing Dryderman, King Burger, Bugs Bear Bunny, and the crew of Star Trek, and the module also included an appearance by Gygax's Mordenkainen in a movie studio. Greyhawk revived 1988-1990. By 1988, with the first series of Dragonlance adventures drawing to a close, and Forgotten Realms doing very well, TSR turned back to Greyhawk in the January 1988 issue of Dragon. Jim Ward, one of the original players in the Dungeons of Greyhawk, creator of the wizard Dromage, and now working for TSR in the post-Gygax era, requested player input about what should be included in a hardcover source book for Greyhawk. He received over 500 letters in response in the August 1988 issue of Dragon. He outlined the ideas from readers that been included, and Greyhawk Adventures appeared shortly afterward as a response to requests from Greyhawk fans. The book's title was borrowed from Rose Estes' Greyhawk Adventures line of novels and used the same front cover banner design. It was the 13th and final hardcover book published for the first edition Advanced Dungeons. See also, The City of Greyhawk. The publication of Greyhawk Adventures came just as TSR released the second edition of Dungeons the same year, and featured the first appearance by Vecna, formerly a mythic lich in Dungeons. To 586. up to the coming war, and then take them through the war itself once players completed the war via the three modules. A new boxed set would be published to introduce the new storyline and the new Flannes II World of Greyhawk Swords modules. WGS-15 Shall Be Won by Carl Sargent and WGS-2 Howl from the North by Dale Henson, were released in 1991. These described events leading up to the war. The third module was reworked into Greyhawk Wars, a strategy war game that led players through the events, strategies, and alliance of the actual war. A booklet included with the game, Greyhawk Wars Adventurer's Book, described the event of the war in 582 Psi 6 years after Gygax's original setting of 576 Psi. A regional conflict started by IUZ gradually widened until it was a war that affected almost every nation in the Flannes. A peace treaty was signed in the city of Greyhawk 2 years later, which is why the conflict became known as the Greyhawk Wars on the day of the treaty signing, RARY, once a minor spellcaster created and then discarded by Brian Bloom, but now elevated by TSR to the Circle of Eight, attacked his fellow Circle members, aided and abetted by Robler. After the attack, Tenser and Odaluk were dead, while Robler and RARY fled to the deserts of the Bright Lands. Rob Kuntz, original creator of Robler, objected to this storyline, since he believed that Robler would never attack his old adventuring companion Mordenkainen. Although Kuntz did not own the creative rights to Robler and no longer worked at TSR, he unofficially suggested an alternate storyline that Robler had